title of my message this morning is Adults Only. Adults Only. Now, when Pastor Jürgen and I got married almost 24 years ago, I was a teenager. I was 17. And a couple of days before our wedding, we found out that in the nation of Australia, it was illegal for someone to get married at the age of 17. So we had to go and seek a judge's permission to get married. We had to go to our local courthouse and stand before a judge. And at this particular courthouse, there was apparently a good judge and a bad judge. Now, the day we turned up, it was the bad judge's day to make the rulings. And so we are called into his chambers, both Jürgen and I was 17, a fetal bride. And we walk in holding hands, and he just sits there. He does not even acknowledge our entrance. He's just sitting at his desk. And he's got those, you know, those bifocal glasses that kind of, you know, make them, they make people look very imposing. And he's just looking down at his papers, shuffling through some things. He doesn't even look up. And then when he finally does, he kind of looks up and down at us at the same time with the bifocals. And he goes, "So, you want to marry a child, son?" And then he goes, "Listen, you know it's against the law to marry a person under the age of 18 in the state of New South Wales." And Jürgen's like, "No, sorry, sir, I didn't know that." And he goes, "And you know that even if a woman is pregnant or a girl is pregnant, that is not enough cause for me to grant you permission to get married." He goes, "What business do you have wanting to marry a girl of 17? He said, well, sir, I'm moved to the nation of New Zealand and I love Leanne and we've been dating for 2 years and we're Christians and we're going to go to New Zealand and we're going to be serving at-risk youth in the nation of New Zealand and serving as youth pastors in a local church over there." And all of a sudden his countenance changed. "You're a Christian? A Christian?" He goes, "I'm Presbyterian myself." He goes, "I wish more young people would go into the ministry. Permission granted." So I tell that little bit of our past to kind of push forward this point that typically marriage is an adults-only institution. But what I've found in our marriage relationships is, yes, we can be physically adults, but the biggest sabotager of our marriage relationships is we bring our childhood dysfunctions, our childish ways, our childish habits into an adult-only relationship. Look at this verse that Paul shares with us in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter number 13, verse 11. "When I was a child, I talked like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. But when I became a man or a woman, I put the ways of childhood behind me." I would say that the biggest problems we face in our marriage relationships today are not adult problems as much as they are childhood problems. Things that we've not allowed the Lord, the Holy Spirit, to cut off, and we've dragged them in to our adult relationships, and they are destroying the very thing that God sent to bless us. So I want to get straight into it today because I've got a whole lot of stuff that I want to share with you. You can thank God I've made some mistakes, because out of the abundance of my mistakes, I have some truth to share with you today. So I want to kind of parallel some behaviors that, you know, we would assume are very childish that quite often we can drag into our marriage relationships. The first one is kids don't lose well. Kids don't lose well. Have you ever seen a competitive kid that loses? There's a tantrum, there's a fit. I remember my son Ashley was playing Monopoly with his older brother Jordan, and somehow he landed on, well, in Australia it's Park Lane, or what do they call it here? What's the big... Okay, all right, yeah, the real expensive one that just happened to have a whole bunch of hotels on it. And so Ashley lands and realizes immediately he's going to be bankrupt. So he picks up his water bottle and he turns to his brother and just starts beating him over the head with a water bottle, and then puts it down and runs into the pantry and shuts the door. Kids don't lose well. I remember going to school as a young girl, and we had a boy in our school and his name was Ashley Thorpe, and it was about third grade. Now, in Australia, we play sport all the time. Like, you literally go to school to learn how to be an athlete. So there's t-ball, there's softball, there's cricket, there's soccer, there's football. Every Aussie knows how to play sport. So Ashley Thorpe, he was a bit of an athlete. But I found that every time Ashley Thorpe lost, it was never Ashley Thorpe's fault. It was never his fault. It was always his teammates. His teammates dropped the ball. Oh, if we look, it was never me. It was always my teammates, or the sun was in my eyes, or the conditions weren't perfect, or I didn't know they blew the whistle and the game had started. There was always a reason that it was never Ashley Thorpe's fault. He didn't know how to lose well. You know, I found that in our adult-only marriage relationships, that little boys and girls that don't know how to lose well as kids can often grow up to be men and women that don't know how to lose well. So you'll find yourself in a conflict, and it's never your fault. Can I ask you this question today? Are you ever wrong? Are you ever wrong? Or like Ashley Thorpe, was it always somebody else's fault? Well, I wouldn't have thrown a tantrum if you hadn't and said those rash things, if you hadn't behaved this way. It's your fault. You're always wrong. That wouldn't have come out of me. I wouldn't have verbally vented all over the place if you hadn't have done this, that, or the other thing. In other words, you created this monster because it could never be my fault. I'm never wrong. Here's what Paul says. He says, love is not proud. What does that mean? In our marriage relationships, we have to learn how to admit when we're wrong and learn to apologize, to come with our cap in our hand and say those words that are some of the hardest words to say in the human language. I am sorry. Do you know how much collateral you put in your spouse's bank when you learn and allow yourself to lose well and actually allow yourself to come in and apologize when an apology is necessary? You know, I've met women, some men, but mostly women, who are in relationships with men who don't know how to lose well. Never their fault. It's always the wife, the woman you gave me, Lord. If she hadn't have passed me that apple, then this would not have happened. It's never his fault. He's never wrong. And you know what? He creates the very thing he doesn't want, a woman who lacks confidence. One of the key qualities that a man looks for in a relationship with another woman is confidence. And yet you look at your wife that you have suffocated and squashed to the ground because you're never wrong. You can never be wrong. And you've made her into an insipid person who doesn't know how to make a decision because she lacks so much confidence in herself because she's always wrong. You created this and now you despise what you've made and you cast your eyes out here and go, look how confident she is. I wish I could have a woman like that. If God gave you a woman like that, you would wreck it because you can never be wrong. We got to learn how to lose well. Sometimes in marriage relationships, you will need to concede defeat even when you don't feel like you're wrong, just to let peace reign in your home. You know what? And then the Holy Spirit will quite often come to me in times where I've had to concede defeat, where I felt justified and righteous in my stance. And he'll say to me, you know, Leanne, and he'll point out some flaws. And I tell you what, at that point, I'm glad I didn't stand my ground and make my husband feel like a loser because I could not admit defeat myself and say sorry when I needed to say sorry. There's such a power in an apology and an ability to be able to lose well in our marriage relationships and concede defeat when we need to, in Jesus' name. The second thing that we see that kids do that we can often drag into our marriage relationships is kids aren't great at sharing. Have you ever noticed that kids aren't great at sharing? I had a conversation with Pastor Shauna, who's one of the pastors in our kids' church, and she said to me, one of the biggest problems we have in kids' church, one of the biggest reasons we have to break up fights is because kids, they just don't know how to share. And we would say, oh, those kids not knowing how to share. And yet, we're guilty of the very same behaviors in our adults only, should be adults only, marriage relationships. Does it always have to be your way? Does it always have to be what you want when you want it? Are you selfish in your marriage relationship or can you share? I was driving with my little girl Zoe once and we were coming home from a church marathon and she was hungry, so we pulled into In-N-Out Burger. And she loves their French fries. You know, you get a big old tray of crispy, fresh-made French fries, fresh, never frozen. And she had her little cardboard tray of fries, and I'm telling you, you may not like fries, but when you smell a fry, everything changes. You can have your diet plan. You can have your vows that you are now 40. A French fry will not pass your lips. But when you smell those things, all the vows go out the window. So I said, oh, Zoe, can mummy have a fry? She's like, Mom, you only get Diet Coke. I'm like, wow. Anyway, I've since stopped drinking Diet Coke, as we all know. But I'm like, oh, mummy's really hungry, Zoe. Can I have a French fry? And she's like, Mom, I need them. I need them. I said, oh, baby, I know you're hungry, but mummy is too, and they smell so good. Can I have a French fry? So she concedes. She passes me a French fry shard, a splinter, a salty, crispy splinter that she found at the very bottom. She literally pricked it with her finger, passed over. Here you go, mummy. Here's your French fry. You know what? Hilarious. But a lot of us drag that mentality into our marriage relationships. Can you share? Is it all your way, all the time? Your preferences, all the time? Well, I want to do this, I want to go there. And if we don't do what I want, then all of a sudden I'm going to lose motivation to do anything at all. I'm going to stay home and give you the silent treatment. Hey, some of us would say, when marriage is ended and marriage ends and our kids ask it why it ended, oh, you wouldn't understand. It's a complex adult problem. Oh, I beg to differ. I'm sure they understand very well, because the things that they're dealing with are the very things that we've dragged into our marriage relationships that we're dealing with as well. Can we learn to share with what we like doing? You know, one of the greatest joys in my life is being able to do something I love with the man I love and knowing he loves it too. I love watching a movie, knowing that I can go home and go, oh my gosh, I saw this great movie. I want to watch it with you, and then we'll watch it together. And I'll be looking at him during all the powerful, funny points, like, yeah, funny, cool, huh? Isn't that great? I love that he loves what I love. You know what? I'm not the biggest fan of the beach in the natural. I think when you have a couple of kids and you know, you have the option of going to the beach immediately because there is so much sand involved. It becomes less awesome. You have to clean the kids, you have to clean the car, you have to clean everything that came in contact with the beach. It's hot, everybody's mad. You know, like, the beach, no fun. But my husband loves the beach. And you know what? I found that I had to start making myself love the beach. Hey, babe, do you want to go to the beach? Can we? And before I'd be like, oh my gosh, babe, no. I hate sand. I hate crowds. We can't get parking. And I realized every time it was like I was stealing a little piece of his soul. More than anything, he just wanted his wife to love what he loved. And so now I'm like, yes, I want to go to the beach. Of course. Let's jump in the car right now. We are going to have a blast. You know what? I realize as I take the focus off me and put him on him. And you know what? You'll be surprised at how much you start to love the things he loves if you get your eyes off yourself and vice versa. He loves the Cheesecake Factory. I'm not a fan, or wasn't a fan, until I started sharing. And he would go and he would sit by himself, and he was best friends with all the waiters and waitresses. And he'd get free cheesecake and he'd come home and be like, oh, babe, had the best Navajo sandwich at the Cheesecake Factory with fries, and they gave me, and the girls come in a hero. And, you know, like, and he would just evangelize and eat himself into a stupor. It was his favorite place to go. And I'd be always like, I want to go somewhere with more ambience, less crowds. I don't want to have to wait. I don't want to get a whole platter of food. I'm over 40, okay? I just want to go somewhere that's, you know, like, quieter, and I don't have to wait. I want to be able to walk in. But this was such a value to him. So I started going to Cheesecake Factory with him. And he was so pumped. He'd be, like, walking me around, like, you know, his prize. This is my wife. This is my wife. I'm sharing my favorite place with her. And I realized it was such a value to him. For me to like what he liked. And do you know what? I realized the Cheesecake Factory is pretty awesome. It's pretty dang awesome. It's surprising what you'll figure out you like if you take the focus off you and put it on your significant other. Can I talk about the possibility of us not sharing or being selfish even with our dreams? I read an interesting story about a couple that got married, and this is why premarital counseling is so important, because it's a way to sieve out whether this person is truly compatible before you go into a binding covenant with them. And so this particular couple, the husband decided that he didn't want to buy a house. Buying a house was not a value to him. He wanted to get a trailer and live by the sea with his wife and their kids, and they could just kind of drive around America like gypsies with a changing view every day. Sounds amazing, maybe for a man, not for a woman. We want a nest to raise our young in. We want to know that there is somewhat of a stable view every time we open our window in the morning, that we can send our kids to a school, that we can have an inheritance to pass on to our children's children. Never underestimate the power of stability for a woman. But this guy wouldn't concede his dream. And unfortunately, his dream was more important than his marriage relationship. The marriage ended up breaking up. I mean, how selfish. We got to share. You may not want it, but maybe she does. He may not want it, but maybe, whatever. The reverse. She may not want it, but he may. There has to be some concessions in that marriage relationship. Learn to live together, collaborate together, and you'll find you can have an amazing marriage, which is a collision of two people preferring one another in an unselfish way. It's a beautiful thing, creating an environment for not just your dreams to flourish, but your spouse's dreams to flourish. They do not have to be in competition with one another. I mean, sadly, this guy could have given his wife her dream and bought a trailer on the side, had little weekend adventures tottering around this great nation, but instead he lost his marriage over for a reason that really did not need to happen because he didn't know how to share. Can I talk about free time selfish for a second? Only what I want to do, when I want to do it. You know, there are some men, sadly, and I don't mean to be picking on the men, but there are some men, sadly, who when they come home from work, it's all about their man cave. And I get it. Everybody needs their alone time. But when you don't have the ability to get up out of your chair and go out on the weekend with your wife who needs social interaction, who wants to go to that party because you don't like being around people, and I'm around people all week, and I don't want to see no more people. Guess what? It's not all about you. Here's what the Bible says in the book of Ephesians. The Bible says, do not give the devil a foothold. You know what? You will give the devil a foothold if you sent your pretty looking wife out to the parties by herself all the time because you could not be bothered getting your backside off the recliner chair. I'm just telling it like it is today. Listen, you got to start to get a bit social. You got to get out there. There are plenty of marriages break up simply because we don't know how to share. We've got to learn how to share. Girls, you've got to let your man recreate. Don't hold him a prisoner in your home every weekend. You were at work all week and I never saw you. And now you need to stay home. And you need to stay home. And I'm going to tell you the whole time about how bad it is that we never get to spend time together while we're spending time together. We're spending time together, but I'm going to complain while we're spending time together that we get no time together. No, you're wrecking the time you get together with your whining and your complaining. You know, he will come back to you so much happier. I used to be personally offended at the fact that on the weekend, my husband did not want to stay home with me and do the things that I wanted to do. You know, you are better off letting that man go out and get that surfing, that shooting, that bowling, whatever that man does, out of his system. He will come home to you happy. You can go do the things you want to do together. But I'm telling you, we have to allow each other the breadth and the space to be who they are and also allow our preferences to become their preferences to become our preferences. Can I talk for a second about sex? Yeah. All righty. Everybody loosen up a little bit. Talk about a part of marriage where we don't like to share. It has to be my time, when I'm in the mood, the way I want it, when I want it, how I want it. You know, Paul addresses this in the Bible. He basically says, your body does not belong to you. It belongs to your husband or wife. Oh, that's in the New Testament, folks. That's not even in the Old Testament, in the part near where he says you can't eat shellfish. It's in the New Testament, post-cross, post-blood. It's in there. Yeah, hallelujah. That's right. Hallelujah. He's a happy married man right here. Look at the smile on his face. Do you know that more marriages break up over this issue than any other? And it's sexual incompatibility. Oh, we were just sexually incompatible. Listen, let me break it down for you. Real simple lack. Okay, if you're a man and she's a woman, you're sexually compatible. It's enough. It's all you need. Perhaps it's not, come on, yeah. Perhaps it's not a sexual incompatibility problem. Perhaps it's just that you don't know how to share. Got to start sharing. Well, I've got to be in the mood, darling. Listen, the mood may not strike you for 3 years, and that's not okay. There is no law that says you can only have sex only when you feel like it. And guess what? Maybe get going and you might realize this ain't that bad. I like it better than I thought I did. Listen, if we go back and we look at Ephesians again, where it says not to give the enemy a foothold, this is the area, guys. We've got to put off those childish things. Listen, they can't have intimacy with anyone else but you. And when you decide for whatever reason, this isn't the season, this isn't the reason, this isn't the time, this isn't the mood, what's happening is it's almost like things are becoming unstuck in your marriage. Sex is the glue in a marriage relationship that keeps a couple together. Now listen, I want to say to you today that I realize there are issues, but friends, we serve a God who can put back together what may be broken. And you may be facing some issues today, and I do not mean to make light or diminish what you're facing, but do not be content to leave it that way. We live in an era where there is so much resource, so much information, and this is worth your time to get busy fixing in Jesus' name. Your husband married you because he wants you. Your wife married you because she wants you. It is unfair, and very plainly, it's selfish if you don't learn to share yourself in that way with your spouse. Can somebody say amen? Are you all breathing still? Hopefully you haven't shut me down on live stream there. Guess what? I'm still going to be talking. Even though you may, I'll still be here. All right. Kids aren't flexible. Kids aren't flexible. Case in point. So here's the thing. Here's the thing about kids. As parents, we turn ourselves inside out to make it so our kids don't flip out. Like they've got to eat at this time and then bath at that time and bed at that time. And heaven forbid if we miss the routine, if we mess it up in some way, because there will be hell to pay. Because kids, by definition, aren't flexible. They need a very controlled environment in order to flourish. You know, I've seen some marriages like that. There's no flexibility. I made up a scripture. I'm not sure if it's biblical, but I went ahead and did it all the same. So I want you to write it down. Blessed are the flexible, for they will not be bent out of shape. If I've learned anything in my marriage, it's to be flexible. Oh my gosh, you know what? For the first three children that I had, my husband and I didn't have a house. Baby number one, we got we were renting a home. We got put out of that home because the owners decided to sell the home. We had to move out of our house the day after I gave birth to my first child. My family had to fly over from Australia in a Mersey dash to help us relocate to some temporary accommodation before we could find some other accommodation. We lived in an apartment with a newborn baby in the house of a very generous flight attendant for 6 weeks after I had my first baby. You got to have some flex. And then I thought, well, with baby number two, everything's going to be different because, you know. And then we decided to build a home. I was pregnant with my second son, Ash. all these kind of things went wrong, things that were outside of our control. It's not that my husband was asleep at the wheel. We did everything in our power, and yet there were still issues, because sometimes you can't control life, but you can control the way you respond. So I'm in a house, I'm bringing home a newborn baby. I've got a two-year-old son, and I'm coming home to a house that has just had the electricity turned on, but no hot water and no carpet on the floor. And here I totter home to cement floors and no hot water with a newborn baby. And then you think, well, third baby, they're going to, yeah, it'll be fine. And so we're prosperous. We're even prosperous at this time. And so we're building our third home. I'm pregnant with my third son. And Jürgen said, we're going to build a house and it's going to be amazing. We're going to bring our new baby home to our new house. And I'm thinking, this is, thank God, finally. And then something happens. Of course, now we know building projects are always delayed for various reasons. And at the completion date of our house had to be put back another 10 weeks. We had to rent a refurbished double garage, me, my newborn baby, my two kids under the age of 6, and my husband, in a refurbished garage that had holes in the roof and possums would crawl through in the middle of the night and poop everywhere. I'm telling you, if that is not enough reason or way for God to learn how to loosen you, then I don't know what is. You know what? I'm happy to say, in that whole time, I didn't freak out. We couldn't change it. It was what it was. You know, there are situations you will face in this life just simply because we live on the wrong side of eternity that you can't fix and you can't change, and you freaking out and throwing a fit because it doesn't look the way you want it to look is not going to make anything better. It's going to make it worse. You cannot flick the witch switch when things don't go your way. You cannot do the jerk twerk when things don't go your way. You know what Paul said? He said, whether I'm abased, whether I'm in lack, or whether I abound, I have learned to be content. I'm telling you, you want to have a happy marriage, you got to get some flex, baby. Oh, I don't have a house for the third time. But it's not my husband's fault. It is what it is. I'm not going to ruin my marriage by coming in and throwing a fit because it doesn't look the way that I want it to look. Come on, get some steel in your spine. You can handle anything for a little bit. And your marriage will be so much better if your husband doesn't have to dance around your feelings and the fact that you know that he's messed up and he hasn't quite provided the way you want him to, or she hasn't done what you thought she would do, if you just learn to have some flex in your marriage. Life isn't perfect, but you can respond to imperfect situations in a pretty perfect way, in Jesus' name. Doesn't mean that you don't feel. Doesn't mean, but it does mean you don't let your feelings dictate your behavior, in Jesus' name. Next, kids speak without thinking. Kids speak without thinking. How many of you have kids? Okay, so they just say what's ever in their head. Their filter hasn't been properly formed yet. So my son Ashley, quite a few years ago, we were in Australia. He was about 3 or 4 years of age, and I had he and my eldest son, Jordan, in a grocery cart. We were in an elevator getting ready to go shopping, and the elevator doors bust open. Standing on the other side of the doors was a very large individual. You know, there are large people everywhere. Don't need to make any comments. And so I'm sitting back with my son, and we're welcoming this person in, and all of a sudden Ash goes, "Oh, everybody step back. Here comes a big one." If the earth could have swallowed him up and me up, I would have been so grateful. Kids speak without thinking. You know, the benefit we have is being adults is our brain has formed a little better than a four-year-old. So we actually have the intelligence and should have the self-control to be able to think first and then speak. I've had a lot of people say to me, "Leanne, you're so quiet," which I don't think I am. But quite honestly, I think the older I've gotten, the quieter I've got, because I've realized I just haven't thought of anything either positive or intelligent to say yet. So I'm just going to keep my mouth shut. You know, the Bible says that even a fool will be considered wise if he learns how to hold his or her tongue. You know, words wound. They wound, and they will sit on even the greatest person's soul like a stain if they are not undone. You know, God has given us a gift in our spouse. Far be it from us to curse what God has called us to bless. I would say if it needs to be said, say it in such a way that it will be received. Sometimes what happens is we don't say anything. And then all of a sudden we just verbally vent. Because we haven't had the courage to say what needs to be said in the time frame it needed to be said, in the way it needed to be said, all of a sudden there's this verbal venting, and oftentimes you can do irreparable damage. Think before you speak. Your words are like seeds. They plant something either for the good or for the bad in your spouse. Can we learn to arrest our tongues in Jesus' name? Ecclesiastes chapter number 3, verse 7 says this: there is a time for everything, a season for every activity under the heavens. A time to be silent. Every woman say, a time to be silent. And a time to speak. Every man say, a time to speak. Okay. Proverbs 12:8 says, the words of the reckless pierce like swords, but the tongue of the wise brings healing. Can I say to us today, let our words have an intention. Let your words have an intention. Because actually, your words will have an intent, whether by purpose or by default. So think about what you need to say. You know, I was looking at my husband not too long ago, and I was looking at him from the side. I'm like, wow, he is so handsome. I married such a handsome man. Listen, I didn't marry a body. I married a person. Wouldn't matter at the end of the day what he looked like. I love him. I love Jürgen Mattesius, the person. But I looked at him. I'm like, wow, he is so handsome. And then I realized, I can't remember the last time I told him. Let your words have an intention. Your wife, your husband, needs to know she is beautiful. He needs to know he's handsome, and you still, or they still, light your fire. They need to hear that, because you can guarantee there's some lurching cougar or himbo out there who'll be happy to fill in the gaps for you and try to break up a covenant that God brought together. We've got to get intentional with our words. It's so easy to get familiar. I heard a saying once about an Aussie guy who got married, and he would never tell his wife that he loved her. And one day she said to him, do you love me? And he said, look, I told you I loved you on the day we got married. If I change my mind, I'll let you know. It's Aussie romance for you right there. Now listen, don't make your spouse have to ask for a compliment. There's nothing more degrading than having to ask someone if you look good. Do I look good? Oh, yeah, I guess you do. Yeah, probably. No. Be forthcoming. Be forthcoming with that praise. Don't have them have to, do you love me? Am I pretty? Am I beautiful? The selfie revolution we have on Instagram today is simply because there's been a neglect at the point of responsibility. Daddies, mummies, husbands, wives, not telling their significance that they're valuable, that they're attractive, that they're beautiful, that they're lovable. And so they have to proposition themselves on Instagram to get a compliment. Shouldn't be this way. We have to take responsibility. You tell him he's good looking. You tell him he's hot. You tell her she's beautiful. You tell her she's attractive. I'm telling you, she won't have to look anywhere else. Ephesians 6, chapter number 16, says that we are to take up the shield of faith to help us quench the fiery darts of the enemy or the wicked. Do you know, the devil has an intent, and his intent is to destroy marriages. And so he will send darts. He will send apathy. He will send neglect. He will send spiteful words. He will send all those things at your marriage to try to take you down. That's why the Bible says we've got to put up the shield of faith. You have to have your eyes open. Be sober. Be diligent, the Bible says, for your adversary, the devil, and your marriage has an adversary. Roams around like a roaring lion. And how does he do it? Oh, little by little. Oh, he's a gradual thief. Oh, he's gradual. He'll come into that marriage just like someone would come into a workplace and take a pen here, pencil there, eraser, post-it notes, tissues. Then they're stealing money. And before you know it, thousands and thousands of dollars of merchandise has been taken and you never even noticed because you didn't learn to wield the shield. Wield the shield. Recognize the origin of that thing, that spiteful thought, that spiteful word, that apathy, that neglect, and put up that shield of faith. The fiery darts that are aimed toward your marriage can be put out, my friend. They can be put out. God has given you a shield of faith. 1,000 may fall at my side, 10,000 at my right hand, but it will not come near me. Divorce may be rising, but it will not touch my house because I'm going to do what needs to be done to protect my family and my marriage relationship from destruction in Jesus' name. Wield the shield, friends. Kids speak without thinking, but we measure our thoughts. I heard a statement, actually, it went this way. Be sure to taste your words before you spit them out. Okay, kids cry a lot about things that don't matter. Yeah. Silly old kids. We wouldn't possibly do that in our marriage relationships, though, would we? Kids cry because they don't want to go to bed. They cry because they don't want to get out of bed. They cry because they're hungry. They cry because they're full. They cry because they're bored. They cry because they're overstimulated. They cry because they're hot. They cry because they're cold. It never ends. My teenager came home from college and his little sister was crying. And Ashi, he doesn't have the mercy gift quite yet. And he said to me, Mom, why is Zoe always crying? I said, because I wouldn't give him my phone. And he goes, Mom, you need to spank her more. It's probably right. You know what? I want to ask you today, is there joy, more laughter in your marriage relationship than there is tears? You know, nothing will make a marriage more arduous and trying than someone who's always miserable, always crying and always has a crisis. Listen, in the natural, you'd run away from those people if you weren't married to them. I'm telling you, nobody's attracted to a misery guts. One of the biggest qualities I look for in a friend is someone who knows how to laugh. One of the most attractive things in another person is confidence and humor. You got to learn to laugh your way to a healthy marriage. Bible says that the joy of the Lord will be your strength. There's a lot of things out there you're crying about and you're creating problems because it gives you attention when you should just be laughing about some stuff. Do you remember me telling you about the woman who went crazy and tried to kill me, right? And we had to go to court and all that stuff. And then afterwards, I was having a bit of a pity party, like, I can't believe somebody wanted to kill me. Where was God? Why would someone want to kill me? And my husband looks at me and goes, well, she didn't, did she? You're still here. I'm like, oh, yeah, that's true. I thank God for a husband who doesn't let me be a wuss. Can we keep each other accountable today? Don't let your spouse be a wuss. They're crying about things that you should be laughing about together. Laughter does good like a medicine, the Bible tells us. Perhaps we wouldn't need so much medicine if we learned how to laugh. If we learned how to laugh about things that really at the end of the day are of no consequence, but you've created this environment in your marriage where you're always sad and you're always needing to be propped up and you're always needing a shot in the arm of encouragement from your sick. Listen, okay, it's all right every now and then, but if that's where you're living, Lord have mercy on your spouse. Things need to shift. Get some joy in your marriage and you'll find your marriage will be stronger than ever in Jesus' name. We were in Las Vegas recently and my husband and I played blackjack for the first time. There you have it, live stream. Oh my gosh, it was so much fun. And we were sitting next to a guy, his name was Boston Ben, because everybody has a strange name in Vegas. And Boston Ben was just sitting there with his big pile of chips, drinking his beer, playing blackjack, dropping the F-bomb every second word. And he was like betting these big piles, winning most of the time. And he's dropping the F-bomb and Jürgen and I were chatting with him and then he turns to my husband and he goes, so, Jürgen, what do you do? And remember, the F-bomb has been the word that he's used more than any other in this conversation. And Jürgen turns to him and goes, I'm a pastor. And his eyes just get really big. And then he just goes, oh, S-H-I-T. I didn't say it, I spelt it. I only swore for emphasis. And if you're going to leave over that, then it's perhaps you just go now. That's for the best. I am bound to do something worse. And then he puts out this big bet and he loses everything. Everything. Okay, and he's already told us he's wealthy. I knew he had reserves back there somewhere. So, and he just, everybody looks at him like, oh, is he going to freak out? Is he going to flip the table? Is he going to turn into the Hulk? And he just starts laughing. He just starts laughing. He goes, you know what? I've cried enough in my life. I've learned that laughing is so much better. Sometimes you just have to laugh. Wisdom from slightly inebriated Boston Ben right there that will change your marriage. You know what Charles Spurgeon said? He said, I believe that there is more holiness in a laugh than a cry. And that sometimes laughing is surely the better of the two. Can you bring joy and spark back into your marriage? Be upbeat, positive kind of people. It didn't kill you. It's going to make you stronger. You can laugh your way to a healthy marriage in Jesus' name. Let's be happy people. Let's not let each other be wusses. Don't let your spouse be a wuss. I thank God that my husband didn't let me emotionally manipulate him. That he challenged me in my dysfunction and not affirmed me in my bad attitudes. And I know there are women out there today and your poor old husband is in a bit of a prison because he doesn't feel like he has the courage to confront you. Can I confront you today in the very best anonymous way? You got to learn to find your joy in marriage. You've got to learn to see the bright side, to see the silver lining. Life is hard enough without you crying over spilt milk. And I know women who literally cry over spilt milk. The kids spilled the milk. I'm going to cry. I'm going to throw a fit. I'm going to say, nobody helps me. Everybody hates me. I think I'm going to go eat worms. Listen, what did you think was going to happen when you gave birth and decided to raise another human? The spilling of milk will be the least of your problems. Do not flip out over that. Learn to laugh. Everybody turn to the person next to you and go, ha! Yes, there you go. You're already starting. You guys are quick learners. And lastly, kids have separation anxiety. Now, I remember my little girl Zoe, who's now 7, from the age of like 0 to 3. Every time we tried to get a babysitter, and heaven forfend that we have a date night and leave her, or in her words, abandon her. She would cry, she would scream, she would writhe, she would pound at the door, chase after the car. You don't know how many times I've been backing out of the garage and Zoe's literally having to be held in like in a cling grip by a afraid-looking babysitter as she cries out with a red face and an outstretched arm and a look of terror on her face as her parents are leaving, abandoning her. I couldn't take her to kids' church without a tantrum. Listen, there are some people that bring that same dysfunction into their adult relationships. They can't exist without their significant other by their sides at all times. I can't go to church if my wife's not going. Yeah. You can. You really can. You're a big boy. You're a big girl. You know what happened when you got married? The Bible says that the two became one flesh. But there's a reason that God didn't make you Siamese twins. It would have actually been better because then it would be a lot harder to get divorced if we just sewed each other up. There you go. Try to get out of that one, eh? There you go. That'd give you some motivation to make it work, wouldn't it? But God didn't do that. You know what? He said, I'm going to make it so you still have legs. You still have a level of independence. You still have a brain. You still have your own personality. You still have your own desires and dreams and wishes and all these bits and pieces. But if you try to make your spouse your everything, I'm telling you, you will wear them out. you will wear them out. There is a reason the Bible says that marriage is like a threefold cord. Not a twofold cord, a threefold cord. The third part of that cord is Christ, which means friendship, which means fellowship, which means church attendance. Listen, if you make your spouse your everything, your comforter, your counselor, your best friend, your butcher, your baker, your candlestick maker, you will send them to an early grave. No relationship can endure that level of suffocation. And you know what? I've seen relationships like that. They have no friends. They don't go anywhere. They're stuck together like a little codependent unit. And they're weird. They're really weird. So weird. If that's you, you're weird. I just need to tell it like it is. Right. So I want to put it to you today. There is one person on this earth that can never be overwhelmed by you, that can never be wearied by your continual coming, that always gets you, or at least gets you to the point where they can bring truth to your world. Listen, I want to love my husband right. And I realize because I want to love him right, he can't be my everything. Jesus Christ is my everything. He is the third cord in that marriage relationship. He has to be. First John tells us that if we don't have God, we don't know how to love. If we do not have the God of love on the inside of us, directing the course of our life, we don't know how to love properly. You have to let Jesus be the center. Because at the end of the day, my husband may not deserve my forgiveness. His behavior may be such that I'd be willing to sever that cord, but there is a third cord in my marriage relationship. And that third cord keeps me when I don't want to be kept. That third cord comforts me when my husband may have run out of comfort. That third cord has grace for me when my husband may have run out of grace. And that third cord helps me to forgive when I do not feel that I have the ability to forgive. You have to let Jesus be the center of your relationship. You have to let the breadth of the body of believers come in and keep you accountable. I remember being so codependent on my husband that in the early years, I would not go anywhere without him. We would go to an event, and if he wasn't with me, I would wait in the car till the formal parts of the evening would start because I was so afraid. If I go in there, nobody will talk to me. They'll like me because of Jürgen. I got nothing here. It's all about him. I'm nothing without him. You were something without them before. And that's not changed. That's not changed. Get yourself out of that confined place where you have made your spouse a crutch and you are wearing them out with your continual neediness, and go out and make some friends, have some fun, have some girlfriends, have some guy friends. Listen, friendships outside of my marriage relationship or friends we have, couple friends we have in together, have only enhanced our relationship, not broken it, not made it weaker. They've only made it stronger. Let Christ be the third cord in your marriage relationship in Jesus' name. I'd love it if everybody would stand as we come to a close. You know, a great relationship can be the greatest joy in our lives. But a bad one, I'm telling you, can mess us up forever. We've got to get this right. We've got to get this right. And you know what? It's so simple if you do it God's way. God's word is full of answers for questions that we feel like we can't find the answers to on our own. Paul said, "When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I reasoned like a child. I thought like a child. But when I became a man, I put off childish things." I want us today to put off and put to death those things that no longer serve us in our marriage relationships. You know, recently I had a stylist come through my wardrobe. And she went through my wardrobe and it was a confronting moment. And she said, "This doesn't look good on you. You can't wear that color. This kind of thing doesn't suit you. Don't do this, do that." And, you know, I had to let her into my personal space and she threw out, I had like three bags of clothes that I didn't realize nobody, they didn't look good on me. You know, the Holy Spirit's like that. That's why we come to church. He's like our spiritual stylist. He'll come in and he'll go, you know what? That pride doesn't look good on you. The fact that you can never admit defeat, you can never say sorry, it really doesn't look good on you. The fact that you're needy and dependent and your poor husband is a prisoner to your insecurities, guess what? It doesn't look good on you. Let's get rid of that today. Here's what the Bible says in Hebrews. For the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and the attitudes of the heart. Let the Holy Spirit cut off those things that don't look good on you. If you let Him in, if you let the Word of God be your mirror, and you allow Him to cut off things that are destroying the very thing that God sent to bless you, I'm telling you, you will have the marriage of your dreams. It is possible, my friends, it is possible. I love my husband more now after 24 years than I ever have. And it's simply because less of me, more of God. Less of me, more of God. When I look in the mirror of His word, I see. And sometimes it's like looking in that Nordstrom's mirror, where I see all the lumps and bumps and all the things that I wish weren't there, but it's good for me. Gets me on that spiritual treadmill. Tells me spiritually I cannot eat junk food anymore. There's things the Holy Spirit wants to get to you, but you've got to be open. You can have the marriage of your dreams. You don't have to go coveting everybody else's. Change the one you got. Change the one you got. Oh, I don't know if I've got the strength. You know, that's where the Bible says, in your weakness, my strength is made perfect. All the things you don't think you can do because you got me on the inside of you, I'll give you strength, wisdom, and power that you did not know you had.